he may have to hire me now.
Well, I don't know. Hello?
We know why you're talking to that lawyer, but they aren't working.
So, yeah.
So, we should, we need to outside of things that is mutually.
Did you see the mail?
No.
I
Oh, okay.
This goes into that.
Is it this one?
Yeah.
Anything jump out at you, man?
No, I'm just told to tell you.
Yeah.
This is the end of the school. End of last year's school, yes. Next one starts, guess what?
I
Pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. And let's see, the manifest, I vote, make a motion that we accept the minutes of June 21st.
Second.
Second, any comment for us?
All in favor?
Aye.
And we had a weekly manifest of $171,426.36, the majority of which is the final payment for last year's school bill. And it's going to be like months before the next bill.
The last fiscal year.
Yeah, last fiscal year.
The fiscal year ends the 30th of June.
So I make a motion, we accept the manifest for the amount of $171,426.36. Second, any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Now we have, I know normally this is public comment, but we do have the police chief in tonight for a normal department head, so if no one really minds, it doesn't have a time constraint, I'd like to see if we have any comments for him, so we can go out and protect the public. So anything particular you want to report, chief?
No, it was a very busy weekend, which is what we kind of anticipated.
Yeah.
Traffic southbound right now on 16 is just brutal for a lot of people, so everybody's heading back down south today.
It's going to be hard to have a high-speed accident.
They've managed, they've had a couple today on 28 and a couple of other locations, so.
Okay.
But summertime's here, the weather was beautiful all weekend, so we have quite the influx of tourism and everything.
So, Lawrence, that container got ordered, or?
I haven't ordered it, I told the tourists to receive it. But they asked, is there a preference as to where you put that?
So any place is going to be, you know, convenient for maintenance of buildings.
But I said, we got to be somewhere where we can back a truck in and drop it.
Right, and not like way back, but, you know.
Yeah, and when you bring it in, it has to come in on this side, because we've got buried tanks and stuff over here.
Yeah, I know we do.
Right, and then one other consideration is to put it, if we ever do need to make access back there, is to put it so that it doesn't protrude out past the end of the building. So, just behind
you can drive in.
Right, yeah, okay. And you also wanted a secure locker within the department.
Yeah, that's good.
That's all set?
Okay. Any questions, Luke?
No, the door should be, comes in tomorrow.
Oh, great.
And then when Randy and I can set a date, we'll get a hold of you, so if somebody can meet it. Shouldn't take very long, an hour or so.
Right.
Go ahead.
You want to talk to him about the electrical, if we're going to change that? About, we have to shut the power off for a certain time.
Yeah.
We have to decide what we're going to do with that.
So we do it. Is there something that you'd like to leave on?
No, our computer system's on that system. So if you need to shut the power off to the building, that's not going to be an issue for us. Just let us know ahead of time. So as long as there's no work that's being input at that time, we won't lose it. You know, if we have all the stuff that's already in there, we know what's coming, we can shut down those systems. So.
Well, we'll make an appointment with you, because we have to get into the causes there.
Sure, we'll be there anyway, so no problem.
As long as we notify you a couple days in advance.
Yeah, that's fine.
Good. I guess that's it, then, Chief. Thank you for stopping by, and thanks for all you did, keeping us safe this weekend.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Very good. All right, now I've got a public comment. If you have a comment about a vendor or a person or employee, please submit it in writing. We will respond. And elected officials are all in the game. But keep it polite and go to public comment. First.
Maureen Spencer, Old Palm Road. I just wanted to remind the public that today is the last day to sign up for the summer reading program. Our librarian, Ms. Crystal, asked me to pass that on. And the Friends book sale that was going to happen on the 9th has been canceled due to we didn't have enough people to run it. So I don't know when that's going to be rescheduled.
Okay.
But other than that, everybody's happy.
Anybody else? Mr. Potter.
Speaking as a former house name is on the variance. I don't like to talk ill about my neighbors, even if they have left Effingham something like 90 years ago. But in the cemetery of the Baptist Church, Milton Moss has been receiving a town flag for as long as I can remember. And the flag holder clearly says the Benevolent Society of the Milton Police Department. If I really wanted to do something about it, how would I go about getting this waste of taxpayers' money correct?
Well, we do have Davis, Mr. Davis is Douglas. What we need to do is get him the information that that's an inappropriate placement of a flag for Memorial Day. Is that, it's to your knowledge, he is should not be receiving a Memorial Day flag?
He was too young for the Civil War and too old for the Spanish American.
Okay. We just need to get it taken off the list. So is that something you can take care of? Do you happen to know if it was meant to be a neighbor of his? I mean,
no,
I'm wondering whether or not something got moved.
I think back in the 1930s when he was buried, somebody back then saw a flag holder and they stuck a flag in it.
Right.
And it's been perpetuated.
Okay. Thank you.
What's the name on that grave, Mr. Clark?
Milton Moss. One of the larger blocks at the west side as you enter the cemetery door.
If I may, I helped Greg put the flags out.
Yeah.
I helped Greg put the flags out. I'll get the word to him. And that's at the Baptist Church. Yeah, we put the flags all together, so I will look into that. And I'll let Greg know too.
Okay, thank you. May I ask, as a member of the Historical Society, whether they might be interested in the holder? Because if we're not going to put a flag, I mean,
said it's a police benevolent.
Yep. Okay. If I may, to Murphy Mountain Road?
Yeah.
He may have been too young for this year. I mean, for the police to know, I don't know, maybe we should
check with Milt.
Check with somebody before
okay.
we make a radical move and remove a flag. You're letting them, every one of them want to have a flag on them, but, you know, that's just the way we are. But, I don't know, maybe that's a rational. I know there's military graves that go unmarked in this town. There's forgotten cemeteries in this town.
All right, well, we are in the process of geocoding them, and if you can get together with us when that's finished, to mention. Yeah, okay. Well, we'll admit Lenny's doing most of that. But.
Yeah, we need to get together. I'll get Greg in on it, too, because he wants to continue doing the flag.
Yeah. I'm assuming that's Milton, New Hampshire, that they still have a policeman that's been out there.
Milton,
Mass. Oh, okay. Okay.
Just take the U.S. flag out of it and leave the holder there.
Right, okay.
Yep.
All right. Anything else with public comment?
Peter Sharp, Effingwood Farms. I travel up and down Munner Road once or twice a week and get some bills.
Yep.
I notice there's a wire hanging down about 3/10 of a mile in.
Okay.
From 153, there's a wire hanging down. It's not a utility wire, but it's wire that's wrapped around utility wire, and I'm sure somebody could reach it.
Okay, I
didn't
know.
It concerns me that it might be dangerous.
Yeah, I didn't notice that the other day, but I'll go and take a peek and get in touch with somebody. So.
Yeah, it's the last one.
Which wouldn't necessarily conduct current unless there's a fray in the wire.
Right, that's why it come down, is when the power come down, they turn it off.
Right. Okay.
That's what holds up the cable to the screen.
Right. Now, is that electric or is that.
No, it's just electric. Just
no, I meant, is it supporting an electric cable or a communications cable? So we need to get in touch with the...
Yeah, they're hanging there.
Yeah? Alright.
Low priority maintenance.
Alright. Well, you know more about this than I do by a long shot, for sure. You know, so if in your evaluation, if you can think of somebody to get in touch with, I mean, if it's possible for somebody to reach it, it might be something that we'd want to get dealt with. Okay.
Used to be Time Warner. Who is it now?
Fairpoint?
It hasn't formally changed.
Okay.
We got notification that they were going to change.
Anything else for public comment? All right. Let's see. FR Carroll Diggendos, we did get the estimate. We had some good news. The cost of pavement has actually gone down $10 versus a cubic yard.
A ton.
And I have not. I have talked with Bob Battles about aligning his estimates on the earthwork with the sections of pavement, but I haven't heard anything back from him yet. You have met?
Yes, I did, and I got him. I forgot to bring him in.
Okay.
I do have the places.
Okay, great. So
and I also have the places on the walkways.
All right. Well, we can get to that. I did talk with AmeriGas, who has the contract for bottled gas at the library. There was a guy in today. He's going to get us an estimate of what it would cost to, for the correct kind of pipe and stuff like that that we have to use. How much a new tank, less the return on the four that are there. So he's going to get me the cost of that. He's also going to give us a list of the criteria for the trench. It's got to be X inches deep. It's got to have 4 inches of screen sand.
Well, that's the other thing. We're going to cut that pavement, that backing lot. We've got to cut this trench, whatever depth, we're going to cut that pavement.
Add that to it.
Right.
Yeah, I did talk with him. He said that by the time you're done, you want it to be, I think he said, he's sending all this to me, but 24 inches down. So I was thinking we just dig a little deeper because we're going to be doing some work on the pavement.
Right.
And then what they do is, I'm sure you're familiar with this, you put down screen sand, lay your pipe, put more screen sand, then you backfill it, and then when you get about 8 inches from the top, they put down a ribbon, right? And they also run a wire cable next to it, so if you ever have to dig safe come out, they can find the line because there's no metal in the line itself. So they put that in there. But he's going to get us all that information. So. And it'll go to the office, so hopefully it'll be in next week so we can get an idea what it would be. And then once I have the specifications, I can go up to Bob, our road contractor, and ask him what it would cost to dig the trench. And then we can look against how much money we've got in municipal buildings and whether we can do it this year or not. I mean, I think we can. I don't think it's going to be frightfully expensive. But they said the best place to put it would be behind it, that little shed that's out there right now. He said that's a fine place to put it. And I did ask, too, about running an electrical cable in the same trench, and he said, no, you can't do that because we're trying to get... But he says, you got a pole right here. They could run a meter right off that pole into anything that the library, when they start doing the work on the library, if you want electricity in the gazebo and stuff like that, he said they could just run it right off the pole, but we cannot run it in the same pipe. Another road, and I did talk to the Department of Transportation on the 22nd, and I got June, and I did get a message back. I told, what I told them was, they were very familiar with the intersection because they just did the work on the bridge. I told them that because Granite Road closure, we're getting a lot more traffic on that. I'm not going to say that DOT said we're going to rush out there and look at the situation, but I did mention the fact that we've now officially expressed our concern to them that there may be something to reconsider because the last traffic that they counted on another road is no longer valid. So it's up to DOT to do what they do now. I did say it wouldn't be bad. I would like to see a traffic count done and then a response to the traffic count as opposed to just past history. So we'll see what they do with it. But there is an official call into them on the 22nd and a response from them on the 22nd in which I expressed the concerns that we had. That intersection is getting more traffic. So that's that. Your list is a lot longer, Lawrence.
Mm-hmm.
Your list is a lot longer.
Thanks. I have an update on the or the transfer station. I had $1,500 on that. That's for the dig it out, the installation, climb it up top, and the gravel on top of that, and then the box. We'll get the box for the retaining.
Okay. And that includes taking out enough earth so that the truck can get in there?
Yeah. There ain't much to come.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Again, we would just, I'm thinking next week we can put that up against the whole, how much we've got for facilities. That seems...
We passed the walkway. I got to place some saddles of $500 and rip up the asphalt.
Yeah.
Concrete out back and the concrete out back.
Right. And then...
And the gate on West Grange Road, they can put a gate up and just stand on it.
Okay.
Anybody put a gate on that sixth row,
right.
Can't lock.
Can't lock.
So I don't know. Does that have a lock on it? Oh, you don't.
I had the capability for it. I didn't see if it was locked. I didn't see a lock there.
It wasn't locked.
Pay close attention.
Yeah.
Because you know what's in.
As long as it's not locked, it's okay.
Yeah, there's no fire access. I mean, that's all I'm showing you. As long as you know what's in.
So, any further, no reason for any further action on that unless we ever notice that it's locked?
Not unless it's locked.
Right.
We've been notified, if you know who the owner is that put the gate up, we notify him that it can't be locked.
Right.
He put the gate up, it can't be locked. We have to look at the tax gap, find out who owns on each side of it.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm coming in tomorrow morning to do stuff in the office. I'll see if I can figure that out.
There's no guarantee they put the gate up.
Well, I understand, but at least just a reasonable person to ask, did you put a gate up, so.
Update on the schedule, a second calcium chloride application. I don't think we need to do any regrading for a while. Everything other than this few places where this last storm it washed across the road. No major issues on the road.
Right.
Not on the one that I've looked at.
Right. Well, I mean, I went over them. I didn't see anything that struck me as we need to get out there and grade it. But I did. It wasn't on my list, but I did drive another road, and it's getting a lot more traffic than it used to, and it is washboarding out. It might be. Do you think it's worth coming in and fixing that up?
Well, I don't think we should fix it until we get the culvert in.
On Grand.
Yeah.
All right. Because I'm saying another road is the road that I noticed that was washboarding out.
Yeah, it places.
Right. But I mean,
I think once we get the culvert in, then we can spray it quite straight through.
Okay.
First, rather than go up and spray part of it.
Okay. Yep.
Yeah, there are places, all roads that have washboarding.
Yeah, I got to admit, I mean, I look at gravel roads, that's one of the problems.
Foundation roads, pretty washboard.
Yeah, but I mean, it strikes me as our next schedule to do it. I don't see anything that presents a problem on delivering public safety. I mean, you might have to slow down a little bit when you drive on them, but it is a gravel road, so. But as far as jumping ahead on the grading schedule, I didn't see any particular reason.
The public road, it washed out. Walked across that one section.
Yeah.
Simon Hill had done the same thing on that, on down to the hill, Colton Road.
Right.
But it's only just a short section.
So your estimation is if we got another moderate thunderstorm, it wouldn't end up causing lots and lots of damage?
Well, these areas need to be fixed, yes.
Okay. So do we want to get in touch with Bob and give him a list of those areas to go check? Okay, so
there's one spot on the Philbrook Road there that it didn't take the run out. Going too fast when right by it.
All right. So, Lars, you're comfortable with knowing what they are to get in touch with?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I checked those out there.
Right.
The schedule for the core sample and Stevens Road, that's supposed to be done tomorrow.
Okay.
Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
So, Weatherby's in the hospital, he can't do it, he sent his man, the man named Kevin.
Yeah.
He's supposed to come out tomorrow, but it's supposed to do it tomorrow.
Okay. And is it going core or dig?
Doing the core set. Yeah, core.
Okay. Yeah, okay. That's it.
We gotta sign this contract for Mitchie. Get that into them to make sure that we're on the schedule for them to do the pickup.
For Stevens, for the culvert on Stevens.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Do you have it here to sign?
Yeah.
Does the office have a copy?
Did Vichy send a copy to the office?
Quite some time ago, I don't know if it's the current one.
Yeah, I think it is.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if we have what was current. I did get one some time ago. I do have one.
Yeah, it's the same one.
Did you
want to sign?
The only difference was is on the bottom here, it showed the something in the name. Elvin should be the SP.
Okay.
So we can cross that out and get that.
Right.
But that should be signed and get that back to me. Oh yeah, we had somebody in the audience that said that they called HEB and got a price of $5,000 to do that RFP. Well, I called HEB to verify that, and they didn't give me a price, but I got a ballpark price of $25,000 from HEB.
Correct.
And they also said that they're going to put something in their contract that protects them if we're going to use them to oversee this project.
Right.
So they're not going to take on that liability, that whole project for that little bit of money.
Right.
They're going to put something in their contract that protects them.
Right.
So I think it was Callahan who made that statement, and he quoted $5,000, and I got a ballpark figure, $25,000.
Oh, so Callahan is from HEB?
Okay. No, Callahan is from the town.
Callahan.
He got a price of $5,000, and I got a price of ballpark figure. I'm for $25,000 for HEB. So.
Yeah. I kind of thought last week we had talked about going with Bacon on that because
yeah.
He's done a
lot of work. Not Bacon. Weatherby.
Oh. I thought Bacon was the guy that did the.
Bacon done the engineering at the culvert.
Okay.
And we got a price from WS Cole for the overseeing the
okay.
Project.
All right, that's the one I'm
sorry. Talked with this Weatherby because he's the one doing the geoengineering.
Right.
And he said he'd be willing to do it. I just don't have a price out of him for doing that.
Okay.
But anyway, we have a price for WS Cole. And I wanted to get a price for
okay.
This Weatherby.
Do you think you can bring those in next week so we can compare them?
Yeah, I think so.
You said he was in the hospital.
He's got some kind of infection or something.
Right. I mean, the reason I think we have a if he needs another week because he was in the hospital, Michi isn't going to have the thing done until later in the summer anyway. So.
Right. Well, we have with this Kevin Wall.
Okay. All right. Now, the list that we got out of the worksheet that we were doing on those things we want covered in the RFP, did that get sent out?
Yes, I did that. I'm going to grab some from Bacon.
All right, does the office have a copy?
send a copy to you?
Not anything recently, no.
Oh, this is just a draft. But this, well, this draft looks good. The only thing we want to add in to the thing is we talked about putting in something if it went over the time limit of so much per day.
Right.
That's not easy.
Okay.
We should write that into that.
Right. Well, and what I'd like to do is send this to the attorney, have him look at it, and we could just ask him to, I mean, we could arrive at a reasonable figure. I don't know what a reasonable figure is on penalty clause. I just have never had to write a penalty clause on a bridge contract. So, I mean, I have, it's
in here, bid bond of 5% of the bid should be included out of the bid. And then he goes on to say that the signing performance and the payment bond as a certificate of insurance. So he's saying that when they bid it, they got to put in 5% of the bid.
A check with the bid?
Right.
Okay.
But we want more than the 5% of the bid for the performance bond. We want 100% of that.
What I do is let...
So what I was going to do is down at the bottom, add in those things that we talked about.
We can make a little list and ask the attorney.
Add those in and then add in.
Right. Do that on a separate piece of paper. Yeah. We could do that this evening. Would you please have these people send a copy of this to the office?
Yes.
Yeah. I want a trail of it coming in. I don't care if it's faxed or I don't care if it's emailed or mailed, but I really do want a copy. Do you have the contact link? Number? I could do that tomorrow morning.
Here's a copy for you. But I wanted to write down. You don't have to put an amount. I guess we can leave. Oh, we can put an amount down. If you think that's too excessive, you can cut it back.
Yeah. What's the name of the person? And a phone number.
Richard Bacon. I don't have a phone number.
Do we have any contact information with him in the office? Bacon?
I know Stony Bridge worked with Bacon, so I could reach him through her.
Okay, but you don't have anything with you on. I mean, this is why I asked 5 weeks ago to have all this stuff put together so they'd have copies of everything in the office. But tomorrow, when I come in tomorrow morning, I try not to bother you when I do that, but we'll work this out, you know.
I have a number for Bacon, yeah.
Yeah, what's that?
It's on his, plan. If you look at his plan, his number's on the plan.
Okay.
You have it
all right, I'm going to back up. Now, I've got this thing signed.
Okay.
Right. And then I'll just check this. But then this is what we need to send to them so they can start making the product.
Yeah, well, yeah, they've already started. They've already got the request to do it.
Right.
But he just wanted us to sign this.
All right, it's only asking for one signature.
Huh?
It's only asking for one signature. There's just one signature line, but I'd like to have at least two of us sign. Change this. This is the embarrassing part, Link. I don't want to misspell your last name.
Yes. Two P's?
One. So I just need you to see.
Can I put that in the signature folder and
yeah.
Go get that done?
Yeah.
I suspect
okay.
They probably want a deposit of some sort.
All right, did you find
it all?
No, it's on the.
Okay, well, I can pick that up tomorrow. And this draft was done by Weatherby?
No, this was done by Bacon.
This was done by Bacon, okay.
he's the one that drew the plan.
Okay.
He was the best one.
No, no, I agree with that.
And it looks good, other than, like I said, he didn't put anything in there, but.
All right, so.
He didn't get down on such and such a date that we.
So Lawrence, when you've done work like this, if you've ever operated under a penalty clause, what were they hanging over your head?
Well, that's what I say. This here is, we're looking at $200,000 job. $1,000 a day doesn't sound
okay.
That much to me. Not only that, $1,000 a day, get them going.
Yeah.
And make sure they got it done with that. I mean, we can give them ample time to do it.
And is that over 5 days?
Oh no, we give them ample time to do it. Yeah.
Well, so the ample time to do this, I mean, but once they start the progress, it's like we had the engineer who said so much per day, we figured it would be a 3 day job max.
Oh, you mean for the engineer?
Right.
He put that in here. Yeah.
Because the problem was with the penalty clause is that we don't have a delivery date on the cement, so we can't say it needs to be finished by August 27th because we don't know if the stuff will be in.
Well, yeah, and that's just bids will be valid for 60-day period. We only start for 60 days. You know?
Right.
But.
Well, okay, so what I'm going to do is rather than talk about the penalty clause now, I'm going to say we're going to do this, but the one thing you did say is that once they got the work order signed by the town, Michi Corporation, in a fairly short length of time, could give us a pretty finite window of when that piece will be ready, when the material will be ready.
Yeah. I think what we got to do is leave it blank until we get ready to get a commitment from Michi as to when that's going to be done.
Now, I'm just thinking that when they have this, you figure 2 weeks is reasonable to start bothering about a completion date?
Yeah,
after they've gotten this, so basically in 2 weeks, when we send this in to put a cover letter saying that we would like within 2 weeks, we would like to have a date pretty positive when this will be ready to be shipped.
You're talking about Michi.
Yeah.
They have 1 year, November 1st.
Okay.
And that's if they had this signed by the 5th.
Right, but I'm assuming that there's been an understanding with them that this is something we're doing this summer. I mean, because the last time I talked to you about this, when we were trying to figure this out, the whole point was is that once they've got that signed contract with us, the purchase order from us, is that they would be able to give us a fairly specific date when that thing could be delivered. Because that's what everything else is going to be based upon, when this contract needs to start, when it needs to be finished.
Until we get a definite date for Michi, we really can't put a date on
that. Well, no, what I'm going to do tomorrow is I'll give them a call and ask them about that specific question. I'll tell them that the purchase order's been signed. Once you've got that in your hands, give me a date when you can have this thing done.
Call
Michi. Okay. Okay. And I'll get this to the attorney tomorrow, because that's set to go to him. And I want to get that out to him as soon as possible so we get the feedback if there's anything we need to change.
We could probably get it off to Primex also to get a free review there.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, well, I'll double check that stuff with you tomorrow, but I'll put down Primex too.
Just for the insurance requirements.
Yeah.
Because it was all
right.
Well, not the
service and offer free. Yeah. They have staff attorneys.
All right, we'll get back to that. I am pushing a little bit because we're trying to get to this meeting in Ossipee tonight at 7 o'clock. So, Lenny, you mentioned the rear door is going to come in tomorrow.
Yes.
Any luck with the air conditioning at this transfer?
Yeah, I bought one. It's sitting in my dining room. I'm waiting to get a hold of Randy and set a date up to install it. It's got to be built in. So
okay.
We got to cut a hole through the building. And
all right.
He's kind of booked up this week, and that's kind of booked up.
Okay.
Maybe next week.
And as far as disability guidelines, just to make sure that when we do replace this, we don't make it 2 inches too narrow. We're all
three. It's going to be at least 3 feet wide, and
right.
1 to 20 slope.
20 the slope.
Henry?
1 second. Yes.
The ramp up, they met the guidelines.
Okay.
The guidelines were developed, and it's in the pictures of it were designed so that it's classified as a walk.
Okay.
Not a ramp. If you go to change the pictures and it increases, you left it with all the guardrails.
Okay.
And everything else.
Okay. So it, your memory is that was built to standard, so if we replace as is,
right,
it should be.
Yeah, as long as the pictures and the distances stay the same,
okay,
it's within the definition of a walkway,
okay,
not a ramp.
Good, thank you. Walkway versus ramp.
It was a little bit of a slope, it doesn't matter, it still has to be the handicap ramp specification.
Well, no, well, that's what we were just told.
What is Bill was saying, it's gonna, don't classify it as a ramp, call it a walkway.
No, but regardless, the building has to have a handicap ramp, so it's got to meet those specifications.
Handicap accessible.
The reason you need a ramp is that the front door is too high. You don't have enough distance to make a low enough angled approach that could be considered a walk. The reason that this would be considered a walk is the door isn't that much above the grade that they're coming off of the parking lot. So they can keep the pitch at where it is. It's called a walk instead of a ramp. It satisfies the same function.
Yeah, is it going to satisfy a handicap ramp?
Yes, a handicap walk would satisfy.
If you have a handicap walk, you don't need a handicap ramp.
Right.
You want to build a ramp out there that's steeper, you can do that,
right,
but it's going to require handicap rims,
yeah,
on both sides.
Right.
It's going to require weatherproof cover.
Yeah.
So that's why it's a walk.
Right.
If you want to build a ramp, it's going to cost you $10,000, but if you need a walk there,
yeah,
it costs you a couple hundred.
Right. So when we have a quote on tearing that out, did we, are we working with anybody to replace it?
We've got a quote to dig the concrete out and the asphalt out.
Right.
And then we've got a price for like when you're paving, you're paving.
Okay. All right. So the one thing that, Lenny, that we really want to do is to make sure that we understand the pitch on that. And go up, throw a level on it, and then 6 feet it drops, you know, 3/4 of an inch. So that when we talk to Lakes Region Paving, we can say that this is the pitch it has to be.
I think my pencil marks are still out on the building.
Yeah. But
use them again.
With pencil.
I'm already getting
it. Yeah. Lenny, you understand what I'm saying is that it's just,
exactly.
Yeah, because if we tear it out, the guy isn't going to know what was there, so we have to be able to tell him that this is the pitch that it has to be, so we just need to duplicate what was done before. So do you want to do that? Okay, you know, some they figure out that it's that long this side, and it goes like that, how much it drops, from where is the door to where it takes the corner, from the corner of the parking lot. We can figure out how much it drops, and that's what we need to do. Okay.
Cool?
Yeah. Okay, cool.
Just going to take the cement out. We're not going to know what we need deep excavation.
Right, yeah, I understand. Yeah. But who knows what he might need to do as far as grading and stuff before he puts the pavement down. We just can't alter what's there.
All right, cool.
The other week, the two of you, we didn't get to talk about it, but the two of you went to a road conference. Was there anything that you picked up there that was of interest? I think it was about three, well now it's maybe, yeah, 3 months
ago,
yeah.
I don't remember.
Nothing stuck?
That's a good one, Lenny. I'll try that.
Yeah.
No, there was a lot of information about it. Started, you know, the width and all that. There was a lot of good information.
Right, because I remember when I was reading the thing, it specifically mentioned liability.
And they didn't spend a whole lot of time on the liability, but unless you're negligent in doing something, I mean, yeah, even if you're made aware of you get 72 hours to come up with a plan to do something,
right,
even if you close a road or whatever. But like you were concerned about that bridge, I mean, somebody getting over the soft shoulder and going off it or something. The way I understood it is, unless you actually do something negligently or have a poor plan, then the towns are really not held responsible for any of that.
Yeah. Okay.
That's the way I took it.
Right.
Yeah, once you're made aware of it, then you need to correct it.
Okay.
But if you're not, just like a pothole, if you have a big pothole, if you're not aware of that pothole, then you're not liable.
Right.
But once somebody has notified you, then you can
draw a letter at a public meeting.
Then you're liable.
Right, okay.
Which, you know, I didn't really, this is a wonderful segue into this. We have been informed that there are, in town, I don't want to get into a particular property, but in town people have placed reflective markers within what I consider the right of way of the road. So looking at this as a general, not the particular, we're all aware of who the particular property owners are and everything else, but to look at it generally, we have been informed by a member of the public that the right-of-way, and when you look at this particular road, you see what the common right-of-way is between the stone walls along the entire length of the road. When we get down to the situation just before Plantation Road meets 153, people have put up markers that restrict the width of the road down to absolutely the graded portion of the road. There is no shoulder left. So, what's your response to that?
What's the right-of-way on that road?
The right-of-way is essentially between the two stone walls. You can go further up the road and you can find where there are two stone walls, and you can follow that down the rest of the way. But there is what I consider the traveled, the maintained portion of traveled way and shoulder. You look at any gravel road in town, and I drove around on a lot of them the other day and looked, and generally speaking, there is what I have always considered to be shoulder on a road of a minimum of a foot and a half on either side of any gravel road in town until you come up to a place where there's a boulder or a tree, and then it might shrink down. But any place where there is not an obstacle put there by nature, there is shoulder on the road. Right? And we now currently have somebody in town that has placed markers on the side of the road that are within the right of way. I understand why it's done, but you can't let that happen, because if you let one person do it in town, anybody could do it in town. Anybody could do it anywhere they want. And
one thing they did say, I mean, you got to look at, yes, the town has a right-of-way, but the abutters actually own land under that road to the center line.
Right.
So, yeah, right. you could make an argument that the actual, I mean, it's probably not deeded.
No,
you could make an argument that it has been stone walls.
Okay, when you look at RSA, I forget what it is right now, 230-something, right? It deals with that one particular problem. People are not allowed to put objects in the right-of-way. Now, yes, you could say the property belongs to them, but there's a right-of-way that you're not allowed to put things in the right-of-way. So
why is that right-of-way?
That right-of-way right there is common knowledge or common practice we're taking as the between the stone walls here. And you go further up.
Historically, you could say, yeah, it's between the stone walls.
Yeah. Yeah. So my position in this case, because this is a particular case and we've had a concern, is I want to inform the property owners that they have to take those things down.
Yeah, and if it's creating an hazard, I agree.
Okay. All right, so
they can't, it's like putting a mailbox on the edge of the road.
Right.
It creates a hazard.
Right. Anything to say?
If that road was laid out like a strip of easement, you only have the travel way. That's all the town would be planning.
Right, and a travel way generally includes a shoulder. There's no shoulder in that section of the road. Right. I'm making a motion that the selectmen inform the property owner, because we have been told by a member of the public that there's an issue, that they actually had an issue in that section of road, that we informed them that they have to take those down. I did make a suggestion between, put it out there so it could be discussed tonight, is that I understand why they're putting the markers there. If they want to move them back 16 inches, and put them up. I'm happy enough with that, because that really does represent the shoulder. I'm trying to be fair here. We could strictly say, is go up the road, measure the distance between the stone walls, and you cannot, well, you can plant grass, but you can't put anything there. I do understand the problem. It's always unfortunate when you have a house that ends up that close to a road. It wasn't a problem when it was horse and buggy, but when you've got cars going by at 30 miles an hour kicking up dust, it's a pain. But that's the way it goes. So I'll put the motion on the table that to get in touch with the property owners and say they have to remove them.
Yeah, I think, I mean, it's great mass.
Okay.
They move them back or take them off completely.
You want to second it?
I'll second.
Okay, so any other discussion on this?
So we're going to make them take them down completely?
Well, that's the discussion right now. We have a motion to remove them. You've got something else you...
Well, the thing is, the fact is along the edge of the road, but the fact that they've got a lawn that goes right to the edge of the road makes their property look better.
Yeah.
So why are we discouraging people from making their property look better?
Public safety and basically RSA 230.
Elm Street, how's that?
It's just a, please. No, hey, Bill, no.
Come on.
No. I've already mentioned the fact that if we allow one person in town to do something like this, we have to allow anybody to do it anywhere in town. Right.
So, if you want to tell me that they reflected that, but not change the change that long.
No,
you just asked him
change
the law. What the entry says.
Well, set them back to 14 inches, 16 inches.
Yeah.
I'll agree with that.
All right, so that's kind of like, I'm really not taking a lot of comment on this particular issue.
Public comment, and it's a
No, public comment was earlier. This is an issue with a select.
It's on this, and it's a point of order.
Okay, a point of order is what?
Point of order, that you've already set precedence on these two boxes of property from your previous votes at the Board of Selectmen.
What?
When they came into question about the snow plowing practices on both of these properties and the sand that was rolled up on these properties. And you, yourself, Mr. Spencer, voted with Mr. Eldridge, and then there was an argument previously with Mr. Selectman Edwards about how you have to remove the snow from the road. And we were talking about spending taxpayers' dollars to go clean the sand off from these landowners' properties because it was too close to the boundary line. So now you're saying that they're in the wrong because they've got these mirror whackers stuck in the grass.
Yeah,
and to go along with that, it is, I understand, I think it would be in the town's best interest to see in research if there is some sort of deed or an easement for this property, because it is not two cars wide. And that is not a traveled portion of the road. Because the traveled portion of the road, by law, as you just stated, Lawrence, would be two vehicles wide. You cannot pass two vehicles at that property. You absolutely cannot.
Okay, your point's been taken. So, do you want to amend the motion to say either remove or place at least 16 inches from the graded portion of the road?
Remove them, or put them back. Stick
them back. Okay.
Whatever they want to do.
16 inches. I want to be specific. I got to admit, I'm in favor of removal. But if they want to keep them up there, but they have to be 16 feet back from the edge of the graded portion of the road.
But I don't think anybody's going to drive on their lawn. Just safe drive.
Right. All right. So. Do you want to make that an amendment? I'm trying to do this properly, Lawrence. Do you want to make that an amendment that we...
I'll make it an amendment that we ask them to set their reflected back 16 inches from here.
Okay, so we have that on the table. We'll take a vote on the amendment itself. Okay. You in favor of that?
Move it back. That's fine.
Okay. All right. Yeah, my preference would be to just have them remove it. Your vote would be 16 inches.
16
so
inches.
2-1. Okay. So I will, tomorrow I'll draft a letter just stipulating that at the selectman's meeting the issue was discussed and the selectmen are instructing you to either remove or move them back 16 feet from the graded portion of the road, which would essentially be their lawns because they run it right up. Well, fine with me if they do that. But, okay. I'll draft that letter tomorrow. Okay. Okay, as far as the modular repairs, it's under old business, it's just, it's going on?
Yeah, Randy and I talked about that.
Skirting.
It says hold off on that.
Yeah, that place, I don't know how, that skirting's gonna last a little bit. What's there? Okay, alright.
It's gonna come to a point where we're gonna have to think of something.
The building itself?
The building itself.
Okay, so good money after bad, right, prior to bad, right? Alright.
Well, we have a, it's gonna be a 5-year plan, so we can put that in the third year or fourth year, whatever you think it's worth.
Okay, just a list of stuff that we're laying. Okay, but we don't need to do it this year.
Alright.
I'm happy with that. Under old business, just looking under new business before we get to the old, the last thing in old business. Still no date on the realtor Wilkinson's one?
No. I don't know what the holdup is.
I'm going to continue this on to next week, but you know, looking at a subcommittee to evaluate what we needed at the town hall library to see whether or not, I was going to try to ask Melissa if she'd come in and give us some ideas on what grants and what sort of information she really needs, stuff like that. So I'll probably try to extend an invitation for her to come to our next meeting or you know, within the next couple of meetings just to talk about that a little bit more. Review procedures for receiving, recording, contact with existing proposed firms working with the town. The reason I bring this up, Lawrence, is because we have a proposed draft here. We have contracts. The office has none of these copies. That can't happen anymore.
I just got that, dude.
Yes, why did you get it? Why didn't it go to the office? The procedure for this stuff is when you're dealing as a select
draft.
It still comes to the office.
Yes, but until we finish that draft, put in what we want, and then we put that in the office.
Any communication we have with a firm that's going to do business with the town needs to go through the office. It needs to go through the office.
It's only a draft, Henry.
It still needs to go through the office. If the draft came through and I wanted to look at the copy before the meeting and you weren't available, I can go to the office and get it. Any communications that we have with a business that's receiving town money or could receive town money needs to go through the office. Doesn't go through your cell phone, doesn't go through your post office box, doesn't go through your computer. It can get into those things through the town's computer.
Wasn't I authorized to get Bacon to review that?
Yes, you are, but when he responds to you, yes, you're authorized to tell him to do this work for the town.
Yes. I brought that into mind. This is the first meeting we've had since I've done this.
Right, and it's not the first time this has happened. This has been going on since you started working on Stevens Road Culvert. We just have to, things can't go through an individual selecting office. They have to go through the office. They just have to.
I thought I got clearance to do that.
You had clearance to talk to somebody. And when you said send the draft, don't send it to, this is what I would say. All right, I talked to a selectman, they told me to call you, start doing a draft on this thing. Do not send it to me. Send it to Claudia. You know, send it to the town office.
Okay, she sent it to town office. I wouldn't get that until next Tuesday. So where would I be?
Claudia's in the office, how many days a week?
Generally five.
5 days a week. If you gave Claudia a heads up and say, the moment I get something from this firm, please email me or call me up, I'll come get a copy. That's all you have to do. But Lawrence, it can't go through you. Because you want to know what's going to happen at some point? Okay. At some point, somebody's going to get very upset and they're going to want to look at your computer. They're going to want to know who you spoke with.
Anybody wants to look at my computer, they're more than welcome.
Okay, so you at this point are unwilling to change your behavior and have stuff go through
you. No, that's fine. They want Bacon to send that to the office, that's fine.
Okay, good, good.
That's fine.
Good, excellent. So in the future,
but
any business...
In the past, you told me to make a folder so that I could take that to the town office.
And did you?
Did I make a folder?
With all the information?
I just brought that in tonight.
Tonight, and that was...
And we're going to make some changes in it.
Okay.
And then we'll make that
all right.
A folder and send that to the office.
Okay, good. All I care is that you do it.
And you had 2 weeks to do that. Write this RFP. You didn't do anything on it. Now I took it and took it to Bacon. And we got an RFP.
Oh, fine, Lawrence. I'm not going to comment on that.
Okay.
Estimated redo of porches at the library, that's a ways out. That's something we need to deal with right away. So, we go back to discuss vote on hiring engineer, project management, oversight grant at Snow Road. The way I look at this, we've dealt with Bacon and we've dealt with Weatherby. We've dealt with other firms on Townhouse Road, on the Stevens Road in Culver. I'm perfectly happy to deal with these people. But the overall vote that I really want to take is that the understanding, so that we can tell people in town, is that we are not in charge of this. You know, we can have a lot of influence. You know, the information you can get, we can sit back to an engineering firm and say, this is the bridge we want. You know, we've researched this ourselves. We like this company's bridge. This is the bridge we want. Design it. You know, put it in place. Give us a workflow. Give us all the stuff. Give us the RFP, everything else. But, you know, it's precisely the experience I've had on Stevens Road indicates to me is that having us do all this work is, from the beginning, is wrong.
Well, the thing that we need to look at here is, once we get an RFP, that's our template.
Right.
So we need a project that we do from here on. We have a template to go by.
So it would be your intention to be in charge of Granite Road and not have oversight of an engineering firm?
No, no. There's no such thing.
Okay, good. So what is your...
The oversight of the Granite Road would be the abutment, the footings for the abutment.
Mm-hmm.
In the backfill.
Okay.
The precast is all done and all stamped by an engineer from the original company.
Right, I understand that.
And they come out and set their truck.
Well, they make sure it's done to their standards so that if there's a failure, they go.
Right.
You know,
so what is the engineer going to do on their project?
Okay, the engineer will do stuff like get us an idea of a quote on what it's going to cost for Snow Road. When we go to the budget committee this year, I've had a lot of people in town come up to me and say, I'm not that interested in Granite Road, Snow Road worries me. So when we go to the budget committee, in order to put forward so that the town can vote reasonably on the amount of money they have to raise for bridges, is they can look at what it's going to cost to do Granite Road, what it's going to cost to do Snow Road. Right. So we need an engineering firm to come in and do a cost structure on Snow Road because we need to be able to present.
We already have that. We have an engineering firm, HEV from Conway, which gave us a price of $900,000.
Right. And are you willing to just take one? I mean, I would rather have somebody else come in and look at it. There's a possibility we can get somebody else that has licensing and everything else that meets all the criteria that can sit back there and say, no, you can build an adequate bridge to support the weight of the trucks coming out of the transfer station for less.
That's right.
Yeah, so we should do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
We certainly should.
Okay.
I've been arguing that all along, that we should look at everything that we could possibly look at as far as prices and ingredients. I've been arguing that right along here for the last 2 years.
Okay. Oh, I don't remember. I remember you coming up.
We should look at every alternative there is.
Right. And yeah, no, I won't get into it. So I'm all in favor of that. Now, do you think Bacon is somebody that could come, that firm can come here?
Bacon cannot do red listed bridges.
Okay. Can Weatherby?
Weatherby, as far as I know, he can.
Okay.
So I'll make sure that he can. But this CLV can, and Mitchie can.
Okay.
Mitchie can do it.
So do you want to get in touch with those firms and have them come down and we can do a site walk at Snow Road?
Mitchie's already looked at Snow Road,
right.
And Ms. CLD is already looked at.
Okay, so can they get us an estimate?
All right.
All right. And then the other side of it we're going to need is what it costs to do the earthwork and stuff like that. So we need a firm to be able to come in and give us an idea. Suppose it was Mitchie to do. They come in, they provide the concrete, the precast concrete, but there's still a lot of work that goes on other than placing the bridge itself.
Mitchie doesn't do construction.
Right.
They only
do. So we also need an engineering firm to give us a fairly firm idea what it's going to cost to do the construction aspects of those bridges. So the same people that you just talked about, you could have them come up and do that?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's great. And you will have them send the information they give us to the
I'll
office.
Make sure they go to the town office.
That's good. Lenny, in a sense, do you understand the goal? This is
yes.
What we need to be able to present to the budget committee?
No, exactly.
Okay, good. So, Lawrence, I just, do you think you can get those requests for them to come up and do that by next week? Not that they can do it.
No, I won't get nothing in a week's time.
No, I meant you can get the request to them.
I can, yes. I'll call both of them.
All right, and maybe get a schedule, and we could present that next week. Okay. Yeah, I don't mean to be a pill about this, but I know how all of a sudden the next thing you turn around and we're in September. So, good. All right, so this is engineering proposal construction. So you mentioned, what, two or three firms, Lawrence? HED being one, but you mentioned three other people?
CDL,
right.
HED does. We already have
to test HED. Yeah, okay, good. That'd be great.
Right. I mean, I'm sure there are more firms out there now.
Yeah. One of us, if we don't close this meeting pretty soon, one of us has to leave to go to Austin. Because we should have a representative at that meeting.
Who got elected to do that?
Well, what I was hoping to be able to do is to close the meeting down by 20 up, and that would give us a chance to get there. So we've got about 3 minutes, but I'm willing to go because I think it's very important.
You think we're also lucky?
What are you going to left? What are you going to let you do?
Yeah, in my opinion, yes. There is any other public comment?
Yes. Public comment? Well, I missed public comment at the beginning. Have you resolved the engineering management of Stevens Road?
Yes.
And there's going to be an engineer overseeing that?
Yes.
Okay, so why is this discussion now about Granite and Snow Road when there's been no money appropriate or raised to do any work there?
Yeah, no,
how are you going to pay all these people?
Yeah, no, I understand that. But what I'm trying to do is to make sure is that we're not trying to do this the same process that went through Stevens Road. Is that we have an engineer involved in the process from the start.
Right, I appreciate that, Henry. I was just wondering, you know, I don't know, there's been discussion of using an engineer at Stevens Road,
mm-hmm.
but if you go back to February when the budget committee met, the selectmen present a proposal with money
mm-hmm.
that includes engineering services
right.
and oversight.
Yeah.
And then it went to the public hearing and the people heard that there's going to be engineering and oversight.
Mm-hmm.
The town meeting and the people voted to provide money for engineering and oversight.
Right.
So the people I think want engineering and oversight.
Right.
Well, so that we don't get half-assed bridges.
Okay, and I think...
And that's my public comment.
Right, and I think what has happened this evening is the selectmen have come to an agreement that there will be engineering oversight on these projects. Okay.
The price that we gave it at the town meeting was the price that S.W. Cole gave us. So we do have money from S.W. Cole to do the Stevens Road Bridge.
I understand that, Lawrence. I was at the budget committee. I was at town meeting. I know the numbers.
The thing was that this... Harry Witherby, who is a geotechnical, does the test boring, in his quote, he has to be the one to oversee that.
He's got to watch himself.
The base, yeah.
Yeah.
So why not have him you do the whole thing?
I don't mind who you hire as long as you qualify.
So we do have an engineer. And we do have to price all the engineers.
Right, but there has been talk of not using an engineer because other stuff is engineered, and that's not how it
works. Bill, as I said, I think this evening you've
sorted it out.
Right.
I don't need that explanation other than to say the people paid for engineering and oversight,
right.
not by the selectmen.
Yep.
So that's my point.
Okay, any other public comment? In the back.
Chris Seaman, 120 Moody Road. I was apparently a little out of order, and I do apologize for my comments earlier, but getting on to the road issues with the roads being narrow. My mother lives on Plantation Road. I drive that road frequently. There's one lane wide, and I will state this again. I think it would be in the town's best interest to research how wide the right-of-way or travel portion is. We made the same in the stone walls. We don't know that for sure. That has historically been a benchmark to go by, but there is nothing in stone, pardon the expression, that it is the stone walls.
Okay.
Given the fact that, set the markers aside, the lawn itself
is impeding into what I believe is the town right of way. I grew up on that road. Mm-hmm. Been traveling on that road for 43 years. I can tell you that that road is not always 18 feet wide.
Right.
Not just those two parcels of properties, but the one at the very end of it, they have some shrubbery, landscape and shrubbery, that is overgrown, that is also impeding the town right of way. And to quote you, as far as the town's responsibility into what the Board of Selectmen is responsible for the public ways and the safety, RSA 230, whatever, you guys are responsible for making sure we travel safe down these roads.
Okay, I've placed that on the agenda for next week for the Selectmen to discuss whether or not they want to research the historical width of that road. I'll put that on the agenda next week. I mean, we're not going to solve it tonight, so.
You're not going to solve it in a hurry that you have to go, I understand.
Well, no,
thank you very much.
I'm not even going to solve it tonight. So. That'll be on the agenda. New business. All right. Any other business before the board?
Apologize, I have a cold. Melissa Siemens, 120 Moody Road. I'm here to ask the Board of Selectmen to meet with the town's fire chief to review the emergency run cards that are currently in place with
the
Carroll
emergency,
County.
I'm sorry, the emergency what?
Let me come up there. To review the emergency run cards that are on file at Carroll County Dispatch Center.
Yeah.
It's my understanding that the town, the fire department and rescue department in the town of Freedom are no longer on an automatic response to certain parts of Effingham. I came to a selectmen's meeting, a whole different board, several years ago, and I pledged with the selectmen and fire chief at that time to put Freedom back on the run cards for especially the area of Route 25, and at that time it was done. And for reasons which I don't understand or claim to know, Freedom has been taken off the run cards.
So your concern is that when they get a call in at dispatch, there's a protocol.
Right,
and you'd like to see that protocol reviewed? Okay, I'm perfectly happy to bring that up with the fire chief. All
right. There was a motor vehicle accident over the weekend on Route 25.
Yeah.
That was a fatality, and Freedom Fire and Rescue was not towed automatically with Effingham.
Okay.
And I'd like to see that restored.
Right, but I am right. It's really the protocol that happens at that, but that protocol is established by our fire chief.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
And whatever response you get from the fire chief after your research and possible meeting with him, I certainly hope that you'll consider the life and safety of the residents and our visitors over any egos or...
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I know a little enough about this, but I know not to say anything until I have a chance to speak with the parties involved, but I will look into it. Thank you. Anything else? Lenny, anything? Barb, speaker?
Oh, I do have one.
Okay.
The electrician, he's supposedly coming next Wednesday. What he plans on doing isn't going to correct the problem.
The problem being, I know what the problem is, but the solution he's recommending is.
I mean, what he did originally 10 years ago was wrong.
Okay.
And he's trying to CYA now, but he wants us to kick some money in to correct it. But I don't think we should be putting any money in for him to correct it. I think we should correct it on his own, but what his plan is isn't going to remedy the problem. There's still not going to be a shutoff in that building. He wants to put a shutoff in the back of his building.
Okay, and the problem with that is?
There's still nothing in the building to, nobody in the building to shut the power off.
Right, but it strikes me that if you have something going on in there and you're worried about being electrocuted, you're better off shutting it off outside than inside. I mean, it solves the problem of an emergency situation to put it on the outside.
Yeah, but I still don't think it meets the National Electrical Code. It's not safety code.
The simplest solution to that would be to ask the electrician, because he, if he's a licensed electrician, he has a code book and he could give his chapter and verse.
I mean, he's saying that you can't attach to a temporary, like a mobile home.
Right.
But you're not going to, but there's no hitch on that. There's no access. There's no meters. It's not, you can't just come in.
Well,
but even you look at in a trailer park, a mobile home, yes, you get your pedestal outside, your meter, and a 100 amp shutoff
right. In
it. But you also have a 100 amp breaker in your panel
right. On
the inside.
So.
But did you speak to him yourself, Tony?
No.
Oh, if you would, because I'm not a good translator.
So, well, from the email, I mean, he's going to put a shutoff up there, which is great.
Right.
It helps, but it's not going to correct
the problem. Well, I understand your concern about doing it right, but would it be possible for you to get together with him and just say that when I do get together with you, I really want to see chapter and verse that proves that what you're saying
yeah. Meets
code? I mean...
But I mean, we talked about replacing a couple of lights and adding some home lights.
Right.
Getting ourselves
I understand. Yeah. Well, who knows what you uncover when you pick something up.
So I mean, I can see why it saved him time, because he wanted this to run off the generator.
Right.
And not having a whole big cable over there.
But that was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
I mean, let's worry about what we're doing today. So if you want to talk with him and then just say, listen, when we get together, it might be handy if you had the book, because I really need to,
I think he knows. Okay. What he did was wrong.
All right.
I don't think we should be paying even for the materials.
Well, as far as his solution, if you want to, we can talk about that amongst ourselves, but as far as his solution, if you could get comfortable with what his solution is, and we can deal with the money afterwards. So if you want to talk to him about that, and make sure that it meets the code and it does everything it's meant to do, so that we're not going to be liable for something further on, give him a call.
I mean, right now, the insurance company can say, we're canceling the insurance.
Yeah. So, are you happy enough to do that?
Yeah.
Okay. So you have contact information for him and
I'll
stuff
get
like
it
that?
From
okay.
Call you.
All right, good. So makes sense to you?
No. The thing is, now that we know it, we have to correct it.
Yes, we do.
Not.
Right.
And the other thing is, if they don't have heavy enough wire to run that module up,
right,
then we'll have to run a new line from the fuse panel in here out to that.
All right, well, if we have to, we have to. But as far as trying to just solve this one problem that we have, we'll let Lenny talk. Is that good with you? Let Lenny talk to him and just say, listen, I'm going to want to see chapter and verse that says this is a legal way to deal with this. Or a code, it meets code.
Well, yeah, you have somebody, have another electrician come in and tell us what we should have, so
okay.
We know what we're talking about, yeah.
Right, so that would be more a question. If Lenny's comfortable with explanation and it's plain enough when it's put in front of you, and his verification of what he's saying is on the money, if you're comfortable with it, if you're not, then we can have somebody else look at it too. I'd rather not second guess somebody that's done a lot of work for us, but if we need to, we need to. So. Fair enough. Okay. Did you have something else?
No.
Did you find a place there that says motion to adjourn?
Did I find a place? That's the
motion
to adjourn.
You
don't see it.
All right.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
I have a motion to adjourn. Any discussion?
Second.
Second. Any discussion?
None.
All right. I'm off to Osipi.
All right.